dorime, interrimo ad appare dorime, ameno, ameno, lanciremo dorime, ameno.
Asatoma Sat Gamaya, Tamosama Jyotir Gamaya, Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya, Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. From the false, lead me to the truth. From darkness, lead me into light. From death, lead me to immortality. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
I have the pleasure of introducing the director of the Bhaktivedanta Institute and the organizer of this important conference. Dr. Singh comes from India and he's a scientist, he's a spiritualist, and an active participant in the development of the dialogue between science, spirituality, and religion. He's also a very active protagonist of the interreligious dialogue for the peace in the world.
I'll open with a short prayer. Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya cha Nanda Gopa Kumaraya Govindaya Namo Namo Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Avasishyate. As we move on in the 21st century, the time has definitely come to re-examine more thoroughly about the science of life, its purpose, and its origin. In this regard, the ancient religious and spiritual scriptures of the world have contributed this point that everything in this material world, including life, is a product of divine creation. In other words, God is the source of everything, Aham Sarvasya Prabhava, as it says in the Bhagavad Gita. This Congress is primarily aimed at introducing a serious discussion about the role of God in the scientific research of life, its nature and its origin. Many scholars today express that we need a new science or new paradigm to understand the deeper meaning of reality. In this connection, I would like to suggest that spirituality will be a major partner of this new science or of this new paradigm. This new science should be a holistic approach in the search of life. It should be objective and balanced. A one-sided approach would not be able to answer many questions in this vital field of knowledge. Both science and spirituality must be complementary to one another. Many prominent thinkers in science, as well as religious leaders from around the world, have gathered here for a very productive discussion in regard to life's origin. This Congress is probably the first or one of the first ever as humble attempt to begin a new chapter in history of the evolution of modern science. It seems that, of late, the intelligentsia of the world have become more willing to openly discuss spirituality. This is greatly a welcome development. Back when I was doing my PhD in the United States in the early 70s, generally most scientists would mock at and dismiss any religious idea as it was considered somewhat unfashionable for a scientist to entertain such thoughts. It seems that science has reached too many dead ends in the search for life's origin, and now they are ready to consider that there may be another nature operating behind the scenes, behind the backdrop of what we can see. The deliberations of the distinguished scholars over the next 3 days will be extremely useful in this millennium for the search of the ultimate knowledge of life.
We shouldn't be afraid to introduce in the scientific papers the concept of God.
We should not be afraid.
We should not be afraid of it, even if this produces controversies and difficulties. But we should try. I have introduced the concept of soul in my talk, which is also controversial. One can say mind in the scientific, and also consciousness, but not soul. So I wanted to introduce this concept. Consider all the difficulties that this creates, but we need such difficulties. Anyway, what is the most important at this moment is the search for a language, for a common language, for a paradigm, for a terminology in which to understand each other. And this is not obtained by removing the old terms, because they have a lot of content which should not be lost. We could say, instead of conscience, let us say AB. This would be not a success. We should use and suffer the reality contained in the terms which science will use in the future. I think that terms like God should come back in scientific discussions.
My task today is to reflect a little on what science has been saying on the question of origins and how we may relate it to religious perspectives. First, we should note that there is no unanimity on the question of origins even in the world of science. Now, the Big Bang explanation of cosmogenesis is fairly well established, although there are other theories now in the making with appropriate modification. Stephen Hawking said famously, "The odds against a universe like ours emerging out of something like the Big Bang are enormous." I think that there are clearly religious implications here. During the past several decades, experimentalists have been trying to replicate the process of simulating the primordial soup subjected to early atmospheric conditions. But we are far from synthesizing anything like the DNA. It is far too complex. The blue-green algae, which is some 3.5 billion years old, has some 3.6 million base pairs. In other words, synthesizing a few organic molecules from appropriate physicochemical conditions and concluding that this is how life began would be like saying that because we find sand patterns in the dunes which resemble alphabets, that is how La Divina Commedia came to be written.
Life and its origins, of course, is a very important subject. Probably it should be the most important subject for human beings. We should know what is our origin. And so I would like to congratulate the Bhaktivedanta Institute for conceiving of the importance of holding this conference. Nature consists of two kinds of objects: inanimate and animate. Inanimate entities have no consciousness. Animate entities are those with consciousness.
Science is often praised for its great progress, and it's true, it has made great progress, but the progress it's made is because of its own self-limitations. And you could argue that science has dealt with easier problems by being reductionistic, by being particular and definite. Yes, it has made great progress, but it's also done so by not dealing with life's hardest questions, whereas religious faith from the outset addresses the most difficult questions.
So it seems that we live in a universe fine-tuned for life. It's as though somebody hit a bullseye in picking out a universe that we could live in. And there are two ways of interpreting this. One is that there is an intelligent agent that made a choice from a set of alternatives. We call this God, or at least I would. The other possibility is that there are many similar attempts, and sooner or later you get lucky. This is called the many-universe, pause please, or the multi-universe hypothesis. So if you don't want God, one way of explaining this is that our observable universe is just one tiny fraction of bazillions of universes.
As we push forward in understanding biology and living systems through a physics lens, it's going to be important to evolve the language we use in physics to deal with these kinds of systems that interact or strongly couple to their environment. About 100 years ago, Albert Einstein gave us a framework, a conceptual framework, to understand energy and matter on an equivalent footing. And that framework has pretty much enabled a number of insights and discoveries during the past century of physics. And I would say that as we move forward into this new century, we should explore, as we try to develop physics to deal with things like living systems, we have to actually expand our framework within physics to deal not only with the equivalence of matter and energy and how to interchange between the two, but also we need to come to terms with information. And in maybe in a conference such as this, people might call, maybe that's where consciousness might come into play as well. The interesting thing is that these living systems provide us with a laboratory to study the exchange of matter, energy, and information and the interplay of these with each other. And I think in moving forward, that's something that we should think of, and maybe that's an area where spiritual perspectives and worldviews can help us as well as what we have in science so far in moving forward.
Life comes from life. Life doesn't come from matter. Life doesn't originate from matter. Matter comes from life. That there exists two categories of worlds, a material world and a spiritual world, and that both have their reality. And obviously the material world is functional, instrumental to the spiritual world, that the material world is not something illusory or non-existent or to be denied a priori. Rather, it is the laboratory of our life for our return trip to the spiritual world.
In general, every man or woman can conclude that during his life, besides the events and phenomena of the material world, he gained also some experience of the spiritual or transcendent origin. No one of those two domains or world